श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्ति भेद विभागिने व्योमवत् व्याप्त देहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। ओम सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्वी नावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांतिः। ओम पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्र रुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः। వెంకట్రామన్ జీ from 17
युक्ताहारविहारस्य
युक्तचेष्टस्य
कर्मसु
युक्तस्वप्नावबोधस्य
योगो भवति दुःखः
यदा विनियतं चित्तम् आत्मन्येवावतिष्ठते
निःस्पृहः सर्वकामेभ्यः
युक्त इत्युच्यते तथा यथा दीपो निवातस्थः
नेङ्कते सोपमा स्मृता
योगिनो यतचित्तस्य युञ्जतो योगमात्मनः
यत्रो परमते चित्तम्
यत्रो परमते चित्तम्
निरुद्धं योगसेवया
निरुद्धं योगसेवया
यत्र चैवात्मनात्मानम्
यत्र चैवात्मनात्मानम्
पश्यन्नात्मनि तुष्यति
पश्यन्नात्मनि तुष्यति
सुखमात्यन्तिकं यत्तत्
सुखमात्यन्तिकं यत्तत्
बुद्धिग्राह्यमतीन्द्रियम्
बुद्धिग्राह्यमधीन्द्रियम्
वेत्ति यत्र न चैवायम्
वेत्ति यत्र चैवायम्
स्थितश्चलति तत्त्वतः
स्थितश्चलति तत्त्वतः
यं लब्ध्वा चापरं लाभम्
यं लब्ध्वा चापरं लाभम्
मन्यते नाधिकं ततः
मन्यते नाधिकं ततः
यस्मिन् स्थितो न दुःखेन
यस्मिन् स्थितो न दुःखेन
गुरुणापि विचाल्यते
गुरुणापि विचाल्यते
सो 22 एंड 23 गो टुगेदर सो लेट्स चैंट 23 आल्सो
तं विद्यात्
दुःख संयोग वियोगम्
दुःख संयोग वियोगम्
योग संज्ञितम्
योग संज्ञितम्
न स निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः
न निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः
स निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः
न निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः
फर्स्ट वर्ड इज स नॉट न स निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः
न निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः
योगो निर्विण्ण चेतसा
योगो निर्विण्ण चेतसा
ओके So last class we saw this atyantikam sukham. So atyantikam sukham. Because if you ask anybody, do you want to be happy at home or outside the home? Where will you like to be happy? And what kind of question is that? Who said I want to be happy? I want to be sad outside home. I'll be happy at home or outside. The minute I step out, it's okay. I can be sad. Nobody says that. You want to be happy in the morning or happy in the evening? No. What kind of question is that? I want to be happy in the morning and evening also. And also I want to sleep well. So night also I want to be happy. Okay. This is the answer you'll get. So sukham is there. But then that is called experiential sukham. So whenever we say happiness, it is experiential. And experiential happiness is the one that comes and goes. It appears as though it's coming and going. It doesn't stay. And it gets disturbed at any given moment. And therefore, here Krishna is saying, Atyantikam Sukham. We discussed that last class. A Sukham that is not dependent on an external situation. Okay. So my wife or husband or mother-in-law, father-in-law, they can disturb my peace anytime. But this Sukham is not something that is going to be disturbed by anybody. Correct? So that is what we must take from here. Therefore, it is not experiential sukham. Experiential sukham will be there. Brahma Vidya will give experiential sukham. But that sukham, no longer I am going to be dependent on something for me to say I am happy. No longer. Even though there will be a lot of pain. You're going to talk about in the shloka number 22 is going to talk about pain. Okay, you're going to talk about trauma, tragedy. Okay, so we'll see that. And we also talked about buddhigrahyam atindriyam. So atindriyam. So atindriyam means not a sense-based ananda. It's not a sensory pleasure anymore. Because no pleasure, no object in this world can give me pleasure. Some objects seem to give me pleasure. Some objects seem to give me sorrow. But we know very well that it's not true. No object is there like that. And therefore, this is atindriyam atyantikam sukham. And it is also buddhigrahyam. Buddhigrahyam. Where did this buddhi come from all of a sudden? Enter happiness and buddhi. I never knew they went together. Well, we have to go back to our analysis of life and things like that. We need to bring in this avidya has to be brought in. And knowledge is power, they say. Knowledge is power. Because these business people, they will convert knowledge to somehow use knowledge for growing their business, making money, power, gaining control. They want control. Business means taking control of situations. And that's a smart way of doing business, no doubt. But so knowledge is power. Here we don't say knowledge is power. We say knowledge is moksha. Moksha itself. So don't, the minute I think of controlling this and controlling that and controlling this, you are welcome to control, my dear. But this, you don't control the situations. And situations turn out in a way. And look at the pandemic and businesses have become bankrupt. Just overnight, just can't make any money because of the lockdown and this and that. So we don't control situations. You do the make the best of what you have. And so this buddhi grahyam. So because avidya is there, because I really don't know my real nature and I have to use my buddhi only, there is no other choice. The faculty of knowledge is there and that is the intellect. And buddhi is also mithya. Don't go away thinking buddhi is satyam. There is only atma satyam. Okay. And then buddhi is mithya, shariram is mithya, manas is mithya, sense organs are all mithya. Mithya means they have a dependent existence. Correct? Dependent reality. I think we know all that by now. So that using the mithya buddhi, the mithya avidya is removed. Like what? Like the thorn, to remove the thorn, they give this example. The thorn has got stuck under the foot. And these days, I don't know if boys and girls have that experience, but we used to have the experience all the time. Constantly, there is a thorn under the foot. And those days, we used to run around and there's some small thorns are there. I know exactly different types of thorns. You ask me different types of species, I may not be able to say, but different types of thorns, I was able to say. And that's how it was. And so they say the thorn has gone inside the foot. Then the way to remove the thorn is to take another thick thorn and then remove this thorn. And then what do you do with that? Now both thorns are useless. It's not like you're going to save it, you know, in your showcase. Oh, look at these thorns. This is the thorn that went into my foot. You know, we have not seen anybody saying that. So we just throw it out because neither of them is useless. Is useful. Neither of them is useful. Okay. So, buddhi grahyam. Okay, we spent a lot of time in the last class on these things. I think 21. Yeah, I think I gave the meaning of shloka 21 also, translated. Okay. So, now there is a person who is going to come and say, Guruji, okay, I think I got it. This Atma is these days, that's the thing. I mean, I have to know myself. And that's what has made me go round and round. But then after that, what? After I know Atma, then what? Okay, I got it. I mean, I've been sitting in this class for the last 2 years. Now I've heard this enough times. I know it. What else is there? Nothing big new is going to come in the next few chapters also. So I know it. What next? What next? What next? Okay. This what next question comes from these people who is always looking for something, to do. No, they're all you know, busy and dynamic people. You know, we all have to be dynamic, and at least we should show our friends that we're all doing something other. Right? You can't be sitting idle. That's not, you know, what will people think of us if we say I'm not doing anything? That would, you know, that would bring a bad name to us. So these people, there are people who always want to say that they're doing something, and otherwise, you know, they don't feel like they exist. Something new. What's your new next project? They used to ask these questions. When I was new to America and all, they used to ask this, what is your project? I said, what project are you talking about? I have nothing to do, but to, of course, graduate school, there are life just goes off. When you go to graduate school, you don't know what happens. You keep aging, and then degree is not coming at all. Nowhere in sight. PhD is nowhere in sight. And someday you just pray and pray, and then parents are wondering, what is this fellow has gone? So many years have passed. We have not seen him at all. And we don't know what he's doing. They ask him, oh, your son is doing PhD in America. Yeah, yeah. What is he doing? Some artificial intelligence. Sometime I told my dad that I took a course on artificial intelligence. So he thought I was doing a PhD in artificial intelligence. So he kept telling all that. And everybody started asking me, oh, you're doing a PhD in artificial. No, I'm still trying to develop my natural intelligence, and its project is still ongoing. And so then after some time, the people, you'd say, what project are you doing? And I'm building a patio in the in my backyard, and I'm doing this, I'm doing that. I said, what? And I began to get an inferiority complex. Oh, I'm not doing something I'm supposed to do. I think I missed something. And so these people are constantly doing something. And I mean, everything is needed. But then photography. Then they used to come with all those days, cameras and all. They had to, all manual cameras, no automatic cameras those days. And then, so used to come with cameras and this and that. And so like this, everybody was busy doing something or the other. And parties, you must always come with something new, you know. Otherwise, what is the point in your being in a party? Like, you must have something to say. Something new. Tell me something. Last time you said you went to Bali. This time you have to say something different. It's been 6 months since we met. Okay. Christmas. Last Christmas we met. Now it is 1 year. Next Christmas has come. What have you done in the last 1 year? Tell me your resume. Where else have you been? Okay. So these people, they are always, I know people who always had something new. Always on top of things. And latest news, whether it is politics or economy or healthcare reform and this, that, on top of everything. And latest what Ford is making, what Toyota is making, all the vans and trucks and cars, everything. They know everything. And so you stand in front of them, you feel like already I'm short. On top of that, you look at them and then, you know, you feel inferior, obviously. So then suddenly this fellow comes to know that, you know, because after some time, if everybody starts going to this Arya Samaj and Gayatri Parivar, Chinmaya Mission, Arsha Vidya Gurukulam, eventually it comes in their life, you know, these things start coming. And then this guy is stuck because now he has not gone to any Parivar. And then everybody is saying, yeah, Sunday, what are you doing? Are you going to this? Are you going to that? So then he realizes, oh my God, I must know a little more. All this auto, bus, this highway, all this over. Now I have to know something. Atma, I have to know a little bit about Atma. Bhagavad Gita also I should know. Otherwise, my status, you know, what happens to my status? So he begins to do some homework. And he wants to find out. So he comes to the party. Then he says, oh, Jai Kumar, you're attending Gita classes. Yeah. Who wrote the Bhagavad Gita? Who wrote the Bhagavad Gita? You know, we don't study all these things. We study Bhagavad Gita, chapter by chapter we go. We don't go back to history and which year and this. We don't talk about all this. We don't know anything about this. Then I think must be Vyasa only, because Gita is a Mahabharata and you've heard Vyasa wrote Mahabharata. Okay, yeah, correct. And then it seems Ganesha wrote the Mahabharata. Yeah, Ganesha wrote the Mahabharata. It seems he broke a tusk and wrote. How can somebody write with a tusk? I don't know. This is what we believe. You don't ask me all these questions. You are supposed to ask. What question you are supposed to ask? Hey, Bhagavad Gita, how did you get interested in this? What does the Gita talk about? You know, these are the questions to ask. And then you ask about all round, going round and round. And Sanskrit. And the fellow is not interested in learning Sanskrit. But he knows a lot about Sanskrit. See, you won't know any Sanskrit. But he wants to know about Sanskrit. Sanskrit language. Do you know Sanskrit was the official language of India? Oh, I see. Okay, that's good. Very nice. What happened today, these days? What happened? We don't know. So this guy, he wants people to know that he's very knowledgeable with a limited amount of work. And so now he's come to this Brahman trip, Atma trip, Bhagavad Gita trip. And so he wants to talk. So this person asks, after knowing Atma, what else? This is the what else for been there, done that. Okay, now I got it. Been there, done that. That kind of person. He also always wants to show that he's on top of everything. And he's the walking encyclopedia. Okay. So that person, Krishna is addressing that person here. Swamiji says, Yam labdhva cha aparam labham manyate na adhikam tataha. Okay. So, Yam labdhva. Yam atmanam labdhva. Labdhva means what? Labaha. Labaha. Labaha means what? Labam. You know, whatever we do for our labam only. Labam means gain. Gain, accomplishment. Something you gain. And gain means what? I did not have something yesterday. Now I have it. Therefore, it's a gain. And I did not have a promotion before. Now I got a promotion. So that's a gain. So all these are gains. And so, having gained the Atma, Yam Labdhva, that Yam is, Yam refers to Atma. Okay. And because previously he's been talking about Atma, etc. So having gained that Atma, Yam Labdhva, okay. What does this person think? He says, Aparam Labham. Cha Aparam Labham. Okay. Aparam labam, another gain, having gained Atma, another gain, manyate na adhikam tataha. Tataha adhikam. Tataha adhikam means greater than that. Greater than what? Greater than the gain of Atma. Okay. Greater than that. Na adhikam manyate. Adhikam means greater. That person who gains the Atma does not think that there is something better to gain, something greater to gain. That is what Krishna is saying here. Correct? So, Yam Labdhva. Labdhva, having gained Atma means Yam Nyatva, having known Atma. Gain of Atma is equal to knowledge of Atma. You can't gain Atma like you got a prize. Like you went somewhere and purchased a car. No, it is not an object. Atma is not an object. Therefore, labdhva cannot be, has to be translated to jnatva. Has to be understood as jnatva. Because I am Atma. Atma is me all along. So there is no question of going and getting Atma, connected to Atma, etc. And so, jnatva, yam jnatva, aparam labham na manyate. Another gain better than this. Tataha adhikam. Look at that. And so, and why there can't be a better thing? Why? Atma project. We should do Brahman project. And after that, there must be another project to do. After all, we have so many things to do in this world. So how can you say Atma project is the last project? You think just because you are studying Atma, for you it is the last project. But for us, we are all very busy people. We are all capable people. We can know a lot of stuff, do a lot of stuff. There's so much more to do in this world. And how can you say Atma is the last word? How can you say accomplishment of Atma is the final accomplishment? How can you say? Well, everything is Atma. Atma is Purnam. Atma, Swarupa of Atma is Ananda. whatever ananda I do, I get by doing whatever project I am doing, it's all atma ananda only. It's a reflection of atma. Therefore, that atma I must know. I must know that. And without knowing that, it's a big loss to me. So mahati vinashtihi. See, the Upanishad says, yeah, not getting that quote. So if you don't know atma, mahati vinashti, vinashtihi, big loss, greatest loss. And if you know atma, there is nothing else to be done. This is what, this is the statement of the Upanishad. Okay. So therefore this Krishna is making this statement, and atyantikam sukham already is said, and there can't be a sukha that is equal to the knowledge of atma. And so that cannot be bettered. This gain cannot be bettered, cannot be improved. And therefore, that person is not going to be looking for something else to do. There may be a lot of things to do, and dharma is always there. Depending on one's ashrama, one has to have, one is going to have duties to do, perform. Duties won't go away. Don't think if I study Vedanta, I'll become free and then I can just do whatever I want. No, this whatever I want business in Sanatana Dharma is not there, unfortunately. The grahastha means duties will be there. Constantly duties. And so, therefore, but I can do whatever I have to do free. I am free enough to do whatever is to be done. And so that first line we have understood. Okay. Now, next line, look at that. Now, the question is, what happens if this person experiences some tragedy? Okay. Krishna is asking, answering that question. What happens? Something happens to him, her. So right here, it's very obvious that studying Vedanta and being spiritual in this manner, we need not prevent us from getting what? Getting hurt somewhere, getting involved in an accident. Accident and all, karma. Karma force is there. Big karma force in play. And so I cannot change my karma. Study of Vedanta cannot change my karma. Correct? Even Krishna had to die. They say a hunter was there, and then the hunter struck the arrow and it hit his foot. So like that, Krishna's life also had to end. Okay? And so therefore, where is the question? So here Krishna is saying, Guruna api dukkhena na vichalyate. What happens if a tragedy strikes this person? That is the question. Okay. And a person can, we can handle sorrow. We have no problem. We are used to that. And we come into sorrow, then we can manage it somehow, not a problem. But what about some tragedy occurs? Krishna is talking about tragedy here. Guruna dukkhena. Dukkha is sorrow. Okay. Guruna, guru. What guru is here? This guru is not Krishna, Parthasarathi guru, not that teacher guru. Guru means heavy. Guru means size wise big. That is why Jupiter is called guru, planet Jupiter. How did they find out that planet Jupiter existed? How did they find out it was the largest planet? All this, I don't know. Don't ask me. This is just amazing to me. Every time I think about it, I'm amazed. Anyway, guru there means big, large, significant, very significant. Guru na dukkhena. Significant, a source of significant sorrow. What people will say is a tragedy, trauma. What happens to this person? How will this person deal with that? Yasmin sthitaha. Yasmin sthitaha means being in that position of having pursued the shastram and understood what is to be understood. Okay. Yasmin sthitaha. Gurunapi dukkhena na vichalyate. Vichalyate means shaken. Chalanam. Chalanam is motion, movement. and vichalyate, perturbed, affected. Okay. Na vichalyate, Krishna says. Whatever be the tragedy, whatever be the event, person can will experience pain. The person may cry, the person may have to go do whatever, go to the hospital, this and that. All that will happen. But na vichalyate. Na vichalyate. That such an experience does not change the fact that Atma is Purnaha. I am Purnaha. I am complete. I am full. Body has to go through whatever it has to go through. Mind also has to go through whatever it has to go through. You see, we talk so much about control of mind. But my mind is controlled by the external situation. My happiness is based on things outside. This is my attitude. Therefore, how you are going to, I may be able to focus my mind. But what happens if there is noise outside? What dhyanam can you do? You can't do. Dhyanam also is dependent on so many factors, so many things lining up in my favor. Only then I can sit and do dhyanam. And therefore, this ananda is not even dependent on dhyanam. Correct? It can't be dependent on dhyanam. Then this ananda is again same as anything else, ice cream ananda. Correct? So therefore, he says, yasmin sthitaha guruna dukkena. Guru is the adjective to this dukkha, the sorrow and the great sorrow. Okay? Or great tragedy is unaffected. Yeah. Yeah. So once Atma is clear, once that self-confusion is removed, once the confusion that I am only as good as this body, I am a mortal, and I have to protect myself. Why? Because there's so many factors that can affect me, that are affecting me daily. And if I don't protect my body and mind, I'm finished. And nobody wants to be finished. And so this is my outlook. And so I'm always... I'm secure now I'm insecure. I'm secure now, I'm insecure. This is how my life is constantly going on. And anytime the security can be snatched away from me, anytime. And so such a thing is not possible because that self-confusion is not there anymore. I am not the body. I am lot more than the body. I am not the body, not enough. I am lot more than the body. I am the Atma that sustains the body. I am the Atma that sustains the whole world. Last time there was a question. Somebody asked the question. Is it Aniruddh? Is it the light that is illuminating? And is it like the light not knowing itself, etc.? Yeah, you can say it like that. The light is looking at the world and saying, oh, it's a bright world. Right? And the light doesn't know that it is a light coming from itself that is illumining the entire world. The sun doesn't know that because of it, the whole world is bright. And then once it knows, then it is no longer looking for pieces of brightness anymore. Because that brightness is myself. My nature is that ananda. Correct? So therefore, yam labdhva chaparam labham manyate na adhikam tataha yasmin sitaha na dukhena guruna api vichalyate. So let us do this. I'm tempted to go to the next sloka, but let us translate this now. So we translated till 21, and the 21 ended with a dot 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 ellipsis. Correct. Okay, so now you start with another ellipsis and comma dot 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 and comma, having gained which one does not think there is any other better gain than that. There is any other better gain or accomplishment than that. Comma, established in which, comma, one is not affected even by great sorrow or sorrowful event. Better, sorrowful event is better. That means an event that has a potential to cause a lot of sorrow. One is not affected even by that. Affected, na body will be affected. Please understand, I'm purposely mentioning it. Pain will be experienced. All this will be there. That too. Otherwise, this becomes some theory, okay? And pain will be there. Swamiji used to say, Swamiji had this lung. His left lung, I think. He had a problem, and then they had to do a lung surgery. And at the age of some 80, he was already 82 or something. And so this is a lung surgery. I think it's a very painful thing. And so Swamiji said, no, go for it. And so they did the lung surgery. And they used to say, I have never experienced this kind of pain in my life. Like that, he used to say that statement. Very painful, pa. Like that, he used to tell people. You sit on the chair. Sitting also used to be difficult. Very painful. I mean, what does it tell us? Hey, Mahatmas also feel pain. If they don't feel pain, that is okay. That is a different. Like Ramana Maharshi and all, they say never felt pain also. Correct? Okay. Pain, no pain. Let's not get carried away by that. That's what I'm trying to say. So, whatever it is, our karma is, we have to experience. And so, but he used to come in the class with that pain and he used to teach. He used to laugh, he used to joke. Okay, that's how he was. And so, therefore, that is why here Krishna is saying, Guruna api, even with such pain, na vichalyate yasmin sthitaha. Now, now we are getting an interesting statement Krishna is making. Tam vidyat dukkha yoga viyogam yoga samyutam. The way to chant this is tam vidyat dukkha samyoga viyogam yoga samyutam. Normally that's how we split, correct? But here you can't split like that, because this dukkha samyoga viyogam is one word. You can't split it. All other shlokas we were able to split, but here you can't. So therefore, you have to chant it like this: Tam vidya dukkha sam yoga viyogam yoga samyitam sanischayena yoktavyaha yogo nirvinna chetasa. Like that, we have to chant. Did we chant this? We chanted it. Okay. So here, Krishna is redefining the word yoga. Okay. Until now, what definitions we know of yoga? We know of yoga as karma yoga. We know as yoga as jnana yoga. We know yoga as dhyana yoga also. Dhyana, which is part of karma yoga, but it's a big topic, therefore dhyana yoga. So many meanings we have seen. Okay, and here he is going to give a different meaning for yoga. And how do we know that? Yoga samyitam, last word of the first line. Look at that. Yoga samyitam. The samnya means definition. Okay, yoga samyitam, known as yoga, defined as yoga, called as yoga. That is the meaning of yoga samyitam. Samnya means definition. Pointing to something and calling it out, that is called sanya. Sanya. Okay. Like you go, what is a noun? Noun is da 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 da. What is a verb? The verb means this. Words, this, that, that point out to some action is called a verb. Like that, if you say, then that is called a definition. So here is called yoga. That is what he's going to say. So we need to say, what is called yoga? What is his definition of yoga? So this yoga, in Sanskrit, the yoga comes from the root called yuj. Yuj is a dhatu. And this word yuj has two main meanings. One meaning is connection. Yuj, yuj, yoge. That is the meaning. Dhatu pada will say yoge. Yoge means in the sense of connection, in the sense of binding, in the sense of sticking. Okay, that is the meaning in which it comes. Okay, in the sense of restraining, in the sense of combining. Okay, that is one meaning of yuj dhatu. Another meaning is it's in the sense of focus, in the sense of meditating, in the sense of sense mastery. Okay, gaining a mastery over oneself. All that also has the meaning. Yuj has that meaning. Okay, so. Generally, so in dhyanam, what happens in dhyanam? So discipline comes in that second definition. Okay, second definition, discipline. For sometimes in the first definition also, discipline can come. Okay, but mastery, since mastery comes in the second definition, all this karma yoga, etc., should be used in under the second definition. Okay, now dhyanam, since the context is dhyanam here, what is dhyanam? Dhyanam is using the mind and focusing the mind on a particular object. The object can be any devata, like Krishna or Rama or Devi, and that can be an object. Devata is my object of meditation. I meditate on Devi, okay, because it is, so it is Navaratri. Now, like that I can do. And then, of course, then the Nididhyasana will come, where now I meditate on what? On Atma itself. Even though Atma can never be objectified, still I can recall the statements of Krishna in that meditation. And the focus is really on Atma. So then what is said is that mind connects with the object. Whenever you think of any object, the mind connects with the object. No doubt about that. So there is a yoga. There is a yoga between the mind and the object of thought. When you are talking to your son or daughter on the phone, then the daughter is there in your mind, very much there in your mind. Even though she's far away, still she's there in the mind. And so my mind connects with my daughter. That is that definition of yoga. So that yoga, therefore also that dhyanam is called a yoga, that using that meaning of binding, connection, etc. And in fact, that is and then that's the second meaning where you talk about mastery, that is also called nirodha. Nirodha. Okay. So in the Dhatupada, it will say samadhau, yuju samadhau. Samadhau means in the sense of samadhi, in the sense of any activity of the mind which is involved in meditation, focusing, concentration. And nirodha is another word that is used there. And in fact, Patanjali Maharshi uses that word nirodha. Correct? Yogas chitta vritti nirodha. That is the sutra number 2, I think. Second sutra that Patanjali Maharshi writes is Yogas Chitta Vritti Nirodha. It means he defines yoga. In that sutra, he is defining yoga as what? Chitta Vritti Nirodha. The mastery of Chitta Vritti, Mano Vritti. Means all thoughts. Focus must be on thoughts and then even elimination of thoughts. Elimination or maintaining thoughts, both yoga. Yoga chitta vritti nirodha. So mastery of the mind. That is how this mastery and mind comes into play. And so the whole Patanjali's Yoga Sutra begins with that sutra. Very interesting. And so in Bhagavad Gita, both contexts are obviously there. Both meanings will be there. Okay, yoga and connecting, everything is there. And then discipline and then nirodha, which is focus, concentration, all these meanings, both meanings will be there. So in this case, in this context here, both meanings can be used. One is connecting. Mind is connecting with the object of meditation. There is connecting yoga. So yojane, yoga is one meaning. And then of course, focus, meditation, dhyanam. So mastery is there because connection, simply connecting is of no use to me. Because I want something out of it. Correct? Yoga, that is why yoga, if you say dhyanam, dhyanam is not an, is it a means or an end, you must ask. If it is an end in itself, then you must be doing dhyanam for as much time as you can. Only then I am happy. Only then the mind is in a particular state. And that is why we say moksha cannot be a state. And so yoga, yoga sutra, etc., this yoga is also means. It cannot be an end. Not fortunately, it is not an end. If it is an end in itself, then you must be meditating all the time and as much as you can, because if you don't meditate, then you are subjecting yourself to sadness. Correct? You are subjecting yourself to this world. My God, this world is a dangerous place. So you better take care. Okay? And so, therefore, we don't go with that definition. And so that yoga is there. So initially yoga. Okay, now look at this. Having understood these definitions, look at what Krishna is saying here. He's saying, Dukkha Yoga or Dukkha Samyoga Viyoga. And this is what we have to understand. Beautiful phrase is used, very important phrase. Yoga Samgitam. Yoga is defined as, now we are going to fill up the blanks. Defined as what? Defined as Viyogam. What is yoga? Yoga is joining. Let's say yoga is joining here. Joining. Viyogam is disjoining. Yoga is associating. Viyoga is dissociate. Breaking away. Okay, that is called Viyoga. So he's now defining what the yoga is defined as dissociation, Viyogam. Okay, dissociating from what? Dukkha Samyogam. What is Samyoga? Samyoga means association. Yoga here is joining, association. And so dissociation of the association. Okay. Then associating with what? Associating with Dukkha. Dukkha Samyoga Viyoga. Why didn't he say Dukkha Yoga Viyoga? Yoga itself is association. Why should you say Samyoga Viyoga? Correct? Because this association with Dukkha is so deeply entrenched, is so natural to all of us, and to a point where if there is enough sadness in our lives, we will say our life is full of sadness. My life is all just sob story, sob story, sob story. That is how my life is. And so that is why he says Samyoga. I'm hooked to Dukkha. It looks like I cannot escape from Dukkha. That is why these philosophies which say the world is a source of sorrow, you know, it strikes a chord with us. It really resonates with us. Yeah, of course it's a source of sorrow. You know, that cannot be a false statement. World is a source of sorrow. And therefore, anybody who says that will have a big following. And then all he has to do is provide a solution, because following will not be there unless a solution is given. Okay. So some solution must be there. And so whatever the solution is, world is a source of sorrow is a very acceptable statement. And so here, Dukkha Samyoga, association with sorrow. Dissociation of the association with sorrow is called yoga. This is how Krishna is defining yoga. Okay. Gone completely overturned. Right now he's defining yoga differently. And all along, and then there is another definition of yoga, right? What is it? Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Su Upanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre. Okay, Yoga Shastre. Shri Krishnarjuna Samvade. Sankhya Yoga Nama. Sankhya Yoga Nama. So there, yoga, topic of Sankhya, topic of Karma Yoga, etc. Yoga can mean topic also. There it means topic. Here is redefining the word yoga. As the dissociation, he says, all along you've been thinking yoga is association. Now I'm going to tell you a different definition of yoga. It is dissociation. This knowledge will make you permanently dissociate, not by a lot of effort. If you have to focus and do dhyanam and everything, that's a lot of effort. And the minute you come out of dhyanam, then you have to say, I got moksha for half an hour. I got moksha for half an hour. Krishna is not talking about half an hour moksha, 15-minute moksha. He is supposed to be eternal, nityam, atma. Okay, it is supposed to be nityam. And so now, that is the definition he has given. Dukkha, samyoga, viyogam. Tam vidyat. May you know that. What that? That which I've been talking about all along, that Brahma Vidya, that Atma Vidya. Okay, Atmanam, Atmani, Pashyati, Pashyan, Tushyati, and all these are just a few shlokas ago. Okay, where did we see that? So just 20. Yatracha Eva Atmana, Atmanam, Pashyan, Atmani, Tushyati. We saw that also. So that Tam Vidyat, may you know that. To be the yoga, which is defined as the dissociation of the association with sorrow. Correct? That is what Sri Krishna is saying here. And why not just association? Yoga is good. Association is good. And we associate with good things. We associate with healthy food, nutritious food. That association is always good. That is what is going to help me. Now you are telling me dissociate. Okay, dissociate with dukkha. Okay, that also makes sense to me. But then this yoga, whenever this yoga is there, yoga means connection, binding. Whenever two things are binding, connected, what will happen? What will happen? Whenever there is a connection, then there is always a risk that the connection will break. If you depend on a connection, then you will be anxious. You know why? You will be anxious that the connection will be broken, loosened. At least if not broken, loosened. Okay, nice house. It is now 15 years old. Then one day you start looking up. What will happen? There is a crack, small crack is there. And then now your heart, all day you're thinking about that crack. If you had not looked up, your day would have been just fine. But just because somebody looked up, mom, look at that. What? What is that? Oh, there's a crack. That's it. Over. The whole life takes a different turn after that. Is it not? Until something is done, you can't keep quiet. Can't do anything. So really, anything is put together, anything is joined, it is going to fall apart. It's going to fall apart. So many things are there. And the glue comes off. After some time, the glue will dry up. That is why the good quality glue is a very big industry. Very, very, very big industry. And good quality glue. And it should always keep things sticky. Except if it is post-it notes. Post-it notes, it should stick, but it should also come out also. Both it should serve. Okay. So it's all wonderful science. No? And great technology. Whoever invented this post-it, I think hats off to that person. Okay, why would anybody take a piece of paper and stick it somewhere? Okay, and then today you find, go look at every refrigerator, there's a post-it note sticking there. And so whenever there is a chance, when you talk of yoga, the yoga is going to be temporary. Joining is going to be temporary. Correct? That is what Krishna is telling you. It is temporary, therefore understand that it is temporary, and that is what is called Vyoga. And you can't join anyway. There's no question of joining. Only two things can join to each other. But when there are no two things, then what? When everything is Atma, then there is no second. Advayam, there is no Dvaitam at all. And so there can't be anything to stick. Therefore, he's just redefining the whole definition of yoga. He says, yes, dhyanam is important. And then through dhyanam, what do you get? You get this viyoga. You understand, essentially you understand the Mahavakyam. And so he's talking about dukkha samyoga viyogam. Very important shloka in this chapter. And this is how the Shastram works. The Shastram tells you something is real, and then suddenly it says it's not real. Okay? Everything is real to us. We come to the Bhagavad Gita thinking everything is real. Then the Shastram introduces the word mithya. Correct? Yeah, pot is very much there. Who says pot is not there? Somebody says pot is not there, just bump the pot on his head. Then he will know. And if he can't complain now because he said it's not real, he can't complain also. He can be furious, but he can't complain. He can't tell anything to you. Then you say, no, it's not real. I hit you. It's not real hitting. It's just mithya hitting. Okay. And so this is a way to counter these fellows. And so pot is mithya. Pot is satyam. Then from there, pot is mithya. Okay. So what is mithya? So you say everything is, then creation. Creation is real or not? How can you say creation is not real? If the creation was not real, then what is this? This class, is it real or not real? It's ridiculous. And did Krishna talk to Arjuna or not? Is it real or not? So all these questions start coming. Then that is why this mithyatvam is such an important topic. Mithyatvam does not mean, mithya does not mean non-existent. Mithya means dependent existence. That is what differentiates Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta from everybody else. Everybody else says the world is absolutely real. Bhagavan is absolutely real. I am absolutely real. Everybody is absolutely real. And what about, how do I get rid of this sorrow? No. In this earth, you cannot get rid of sorrow. You have to escape earth. Escape velocity. You have to sit in a rocket and leave. Only then you can be happy. Whole world is hooked on to this. This is called, everything is Dvaita. Christianity is Dvaita. Islam is Dvaita. All other Dvaita. We have enough philosophy. Before Christianity has come and Islam has come, we've had enough Dvaita. You've had enough. And so here Krishna is giving a different perspective to us. And so we will continue this discussion in the next class. So the main thing we study here is in shloka number 22, we saw that having gained this Brahma Vidya, this Atma, there cannot be anything else better. There cannot be anything else better. This clarity we will get slowly. And that's what Krishna mentioned here. There is no other special thing that I have to know or do, etc., in order for me to be adequate. Know that I am adequate, complete, and full. We'll continue this discussion in the next class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Thank you.